This is Steve Cameron, and I have Phil Singer on the line. How you doing today, Phil?
Doing okay. How are you, Steve?
Can you please tell everybody listening what the situation is with Vince?
Yeah, Vince Salandria died a few days ago. Today is Friday, August 28th, 2020. He died a few days ago. I believe he was 92. And Vince was a Philadelphia lawyer that was one of the very first guys to get into the researching of the John F. Kennedy assassination, him and his brother-in-law, Harold Feldman. And they pretty much predicted before Oswald was killed by Ruby that Oswald would probably be silent and not live to have a trial. And sure enough, that happened, of course, as we all know, on Sunday, November 24th, 1963.
Captain Prince, there is a prisoner. There is Lee. He's been shot. Lee Oswald has been shot. There's a man with a gun. Absolute panic. Absolute panic here in the basement of Dallas Police Headquarters. Detectives have their guns drawn. There is no question about it. Oswald has been shot at point-blank range.
Salandria and his brother-in-law, Harold Feldman, before the Warren Report ever came out in September of 64, went to Dallas from the Philadelphia area and were interviewing witnesses and Oswald's mother, Marguerite. And, you know, Vince was an extremely important first-generation researcher, along with the other names that might be more famous, like Mark Lane and Harold Weisberg and others.
On the weekend of the assassination, I discussed this with my then-brother-in-law, Harold Feldman, who wrote on this matter and since has died. And we talked about Oswald, the alleged assassin. And we said that one had to maintain an open mind on the issue of whether or not he was the assassin and whether or not there was a conspiracy. But that open mind would have to close if during the course of the weekend, Oswald was killed. When Oswald was killed, both of us decided that this was a matter which could not be entrusted to the government, that the investigation of it would have to be undertaken by private individuals, and that perhaps we would, on this matter, have to do work ourselves.
Salandria was getting articles written and published, you know, in the mid-60s. And the key that always impressed me is initially he, like many of us, got caught up on what happened on Elm Street, meaning how many shots, trajectories, wounds. And I think he realized by the end of the decade of the 60s that we're wasting our time on who was the shooter, what rifle, what ammunition, what was the sequence, you know, what was the spacing of the shots, which shots hit, which ones missed. He came to realize more or less that that's obvious, that there was a conspiracy, that there was multiple shooters from more than one direction. They all weren't one shooter from behind. And he more or less said, we're spinning our wheels and they want us to do that, get caught up, the people behind this, the conspirators behind the killing of Kennedy, were probably smiling and laughing that so many researchers were trying, even to this day, 2020, are trying to figure out, okay, this person, and you know, you read the books, there's names that come out behind the picket fence, and this person on the sixth floor of the book depository, southeast window. Mm-hmm. This person in the southwest window,
right.
In the Dale Tech building, in the county records, and maybe even, you know, a sewer at street level. You know, there's people that theorize that.
I have a quote here in front of me from Salandria. He's talking about his book called False Mystery, published in 1999. And in the foreword, he wrote the following. I wrote essays on the assassination not to demonstrate any skills I had as a writer or as a scholar, since my writings clearly show my limitations as such. Rather, I wrote these pieces to explain how easy it was to come to the truth of how and why our national security state killed President Kennedy in order to perpetuate the Cold War. So it sounds like he had gotten past that minutia that you were just talking
right.
about.
Early on, you know, he, like everybody else, you know, would read the newspaper accounts in 63 and 64, cut out articles from magazines, finally read the Warren Report in September 64. A couple months later, the 26 signs were released, and he got caught up, like a lot of us, in the details of what happened on Elm Street, and he would write articles that would be published in magazines, and Harold Feldman did too, his mm-hmm. brother-in-law, about the grass, you know, witnesses, and how many people thought at least one shot was fired from behind the picket fence area. But he came to realize, Salandria did, that we're wasting our time on that. It doesn't matter. It's obvious that there was more than one shooter. It's obvious there was a conspiracy and a big cover-up. And then he started to focus on not who the employees were, but who the employer was. You know,
yes.
it's, you know, not just who pulled the trigger, but who was behind it, who was paying the person to pull the trigger of the rifle in Dealey Plaza. Okay, who were they working for? Who put it together? Who organized it? Who had the ability to cover up, and why? You know, why was this done? Why was Kennedy killed? What was the reason to get him out of office and to get Lyndon Johnson in? And he came to believe it was our own government. And, yeah, he was a real important guy from the beginning. And he was a humble guy. You know, he wasn't looking for fame and recognition and money and status. He just felt his duty, from what I could tell as an American citizen, that, you know, our president's been killed, and we need to know what happened. We need to know the truth, and he knew we weren't being told the truth.
Okay, well, Phil, thank you very much for giving us that update. Many people that are probably familiar with Vince's work may not have known that he passed away. Do you have any final thoughts besides anything that you just touched upon about Vince or his work? Or
if you don't know about Vince, if somebody's listening, to learn a little bit more about his contributions to the case, his bravery, you know, going down to Dallas in 64 with his brother-in-law, Harold Feldman, this wasn't a safe thing to do. And
especially in the early days, from what I'm told.
Oh, yeah, to be down there, and they were monitored, they were watched, and I think they knew it. And but they were very brave, they were courageous guys that felt, hey, you know, and they did it out of their own, you know, time and money. You know, they did this not to make money or to become famous, but they just knew something's messed up. And they realized that, I think, mostly when Oswald was killed by Ruby on November 24th, 63. But there was other pieces about the shooting that they realized, you know, like people who thought the shots came from the grass, you know, or saw a puff of smoke there. And they realized from the beginning that it sounds like this is more than just one person. And at first the rifle was a Mauser, and then it became a Mannlicher Kirkcano, and they saw some of these issues early on and realized, you know, are these just mistakes where people were misquoted, or is there, like, something going on here?
Mm-hmm.
And then when Oswald gets killed in the police station, handcuffed a detective, James Lavelle, on live TV. It was like that was enough for them to know something really fishy is going on. So yeah, they were on it right from the beginning. And these guys were, you know, just private citizens that decided, you know, hey, we need to look into this. You know, we can't assume the government's going to get to the bottom of this. We need to just, and they just decided on their own, let's go to Dallas, let's do our own little investigation here and see what we can learn. And and they did.
Well, I really appreciate you telling us all more about Vince and his work. Just for people that may not know, you were a member of Mark Lane's Citizen Commission of Inquiry in the mid-1970s. You've done a lot of work on the case yourself, haven't you?
Yeah, I was part of the Citizens Commission of Inquiry. This was in 75 and 76, and we were trying to get the case reopened, and we played a role in it. I played a tiny role in all of that.
I'll make sure this news about Vince gets out, okay?
Yeah, great. Thank you, Steve.
Thank you.